Greetings from the Westminster Presbyterian Church in Berkeley Heights, New Jersey. I am George Betz. I am the pastor, and I am so glad to be with you out in virtual land. Again, I want to thank our leaders in worship, Mike Goetjen, our minister of music, Larry Cunningham, our liturgist, Rosemary Clayton, and Dave Christie, the members of our choir. Thank you all for making this service possible and joy-filled. A few items. I am married to one of the happiest women in the world, and why? I hooked up Meredith Gas cooktop yesterday, and for the first time in 26 and a half years, she cooked dinner with gas. And I gotta tell you, it was wonderful. And on Friday, we get our gas conversion hooked up to our current oil burner, and we are going to be 100% gas. Thank you very much, Pico. One more item. Occasionally, members of our church mail me some things and share some things with me, and this past week is no exception. I got a wonderful page of humor and jokes from Fred Brugman's, and one of them really caught my eye. It goes this way. All men should make coffee for their women. It says so right in the Bible. He brews. Pretty good, Fred. Thank you very much. Let's commence with our worship.
Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. I have what you need, but you keep on searching. I've done all the work, but you keep on working. When you're running on empty and you can't find the remedy, just come to the well. You could spend your whole life chasing what's missing, but that empty inside, it just ain't gonna listen. Nothing can satisfy. And the world leaves you high and dry. Just come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more. And all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try. Come to the well. So bring me your heart, no matter how broken. Just come as you are, when your last prayer is spoken. Just rest in my arms a while, you'll feel the change, my child, when you come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more. And all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fail. So leave it all behind and come to the behind. Now that you're full of love beyond measure, your joy's gonna flow like a stream in the desert. Soon all the world will see the living water is found in me, 'cause you've come to the well. Yeah. And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fail, so leave it all behind and come to the well. Leave it all behind and come to the well.
Please join me in the call to worship. This is the Lord's day. We are the Lord's people. We are here to worship, to remember who we are and whose we are. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." As followers of Jesus, we gather to affirm and celebrate his way, his truth, and his life. Let us worship the God we know in Christ Jesus the Lord. Prayer of invocation. Holy God, Lord of the past, present, and future, we stand in awe of your holiness, your power, your greatness, your all-embracing love, and your amazing grace that transforms us on a daily basis. We ask that our time of worship would be an experience in holy awe, a time when we put aside the many concerns that consume and distract us, and help us focus ourselves, our whole selves, on you. We pray this in the name that is above every name. Amen. The reading of the word this morning is from the book of John, chapter 4, a very familiar story. Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired of his journey, was sitting by the well, and it was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. "The Samaritan woman said to you, 'How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?' Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it was that's saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will then become in them a spring of water gushing up for eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on the mountain, but you say this place where people must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You will worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us." Jesus said to her, "I am he. I am the one who is speaking to you." Just then the disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman. But no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I've ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" They left the city and they were on his way to him. Many Samaritans from the city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I had ever done." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with him, and he stayed there for 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard it for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Jesus, be my eyes. Before the day rushes in, with you is where I begin. As you sing over me with your love, I will sing praise for all you have done. Fill my heart as I hunger for you. Flood my mind with your wisdom, your mercy, your truth. Father, make me a river. Come, living water, flow through me. You are the one that I thirst for. So come, living water, step I take. Lord, let me not wander away. Father, fill every word I speak with the same grace that you've given me. Touch the world with my hands, they are yours. Let my love show the lost that you are the Lord. Let the river flow.
We come to that time in our service of worship where God's people say our prayers. And as we have been doing for the past few weeks, I am leading in a combination of standard pastoral prayer and bidding prayer. And I would like to continue that practice this week. One personal note before I lead in prayer, and that is, I did an exercise this week that really, really made me feel positive, made me feel good, and lifted my spirits. This is what I did. I took out a legal pad, and I began to list the people in my life who have been a blessing to me. And I kept writing and writing and writing, and the more names I put on that sheet, the better I felt. I would commend this exercise to you because it will enhance your spiritual life, your psychological life, as well as your physical health. In that spirit, let us join in prayer. Lord, we begin by saying to you, thank you so much for the many people in our lives who have been blessings to us and who have made a major difference. Listen to us as we begin to list them. Lord, we continue to pray for the many, many, many people who continue to be affected by COVID-19. We pray especially for those people who continue to grieve over the loss of loved ones to that virus. Give them your comfort. Give them your peace. Give them your presence as they continue to walk through this darkest of valleys. Lord, we pray for those children, youth, that are recommencing in-person classrooms. Lord, we pray that you would continue to guide and lead and energize not only the kids, but also their parents. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we continue also to pray for those people who continue to suffer as a result of the horrendous weather that continues throughout our nation. For people suffering from severe snow, those people who are suffering from too much rain, we lift them up and we pray for them. And Lord, we consider our nation. We consider all of the strife, the disunion, just all of the battles going on, partisanship. And Lord, we lift up and we pray for the healing of our nation. Again, inspire and lead and give our leaders a godly wisdom. Hear our prayer. And Lord, we continue to pray for your church, this local church, as well as your worldwide church. We pray particularly for those Christians, those missionaries who can continue to suffer great persecution as they live out and they practice their faith. Lord, hear our prayer as we pray for them. And Lord, again, we pray that you would grow us in faith as well as our faithfulness. In your strong name, we pray this. And we pray that prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I deliver my proclamation. I just like to lift up one announcement, and it comes from our worship committee. This year, we are not going to be purchasing Easter flowers. And so in lieu of Easter flowers, we have decided that we will take the money that would have gone toward flowers, and we are going to give it to Family Promise. And so I am encouraging all of our worshipers, all of our members, to send a check to Westminster for Family Promise, and this will be our Easter offering. Thank you so much for your graciousness and your generosity. Please pray with me. Lord, we have listened to a wonderful and well-known story read. Help us hear your message through this story anew, and help me interpret it and expound it with insight, with power, with grace, and with love. In your strong name I pray this. Amen. The text you have just heard Larry Cunningham read is probably the most discussed, analyzed, and studied conversation in all of the Bible. But first, a few points to note on this passage. First, we see Jesus pushing the proverbial boundaries by entering the region of Samaria. You see, Samaria was pretty much out of bounds for the Jew. As a result of Jews intermarrying with an Assyrian culture, Samaritans were considered by the Jews inferior, second-class people. In fact, Samaritans were hated by the Jews. Second, we note that no self-respecting woman would go at broad daylight, 12 o'clock noon, to get water. This just was not done by respectable women. Jewish men also did not associate with Samaritan women. But here again, we see Jesus interacting with and having a very, very interesting conversation. This conversation between Jesus and the Samaritan woman, it's a conversation that is not going very well. In fact, we see a number of total disconnects. Jesus begins the conversation, "Give me a drink." And the woman is perceptive. She says, "What are you doing, a Jew? What are you doing talking to a Samaritan woman and asking her for a drink?" Jesus keeps talking about this woman's deep thirst and the living water that he is about to give her. And note that he is talking metaphorically, and she just doesn't have a clue. She doesn't get it. "Sir, you don't even have a bucket. The well is deep. Where do you get this living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well?" Still on disconnect, permit an observation on Jesus. Jesus' way of teaching took many forms, and one way he taught was in parables, and another way he used metaphors to get big points across concerning the kingdom of heaven and the way God deals with us. And here is a case where a woman is taking his metaphor of living water and thinking literally. In fact, she says, "Hey, give me some of this water so I can, I don't have to come back here to the well." And Jesus is saying, "Hey, lady, I'm not talking about your physical thirst. I'm talking about your spiritual thirst, your parched, dry soul. Don't you get it?" Of course, all of us who have been around the church for some time, which is most of us in this virtual congregation, we really understand this, don't we? Living water, the authentic and real and vital life that Jesus offers us, the spring of water that just flows forth and just creates in us new and just healthy people. question. Why do we remain so thirsty? Why do we continue to thirst? Why do we continue in relationships that we want to be healthy but somehow are not? Why do we continue to thirst for intimacy, love, caring, and belonging? Why do we ache for that proverbial something more, but somehow that something more never happens? We thirst for a deeper spirituality, a deeper, more meaningful relationship with God, but so many of us settle for religion as usual. Back to the conversation. Sir, this living water you're talking about, boy, this sounds cool. Hey, give me some of it. You know something? I don't have to come back to this well all the time. She continues to miss the point. And then notice, Jesus shifts the conversation. He goes deeper. He goes personal. He also, I suggest, he gets threatening. Lady, go and call your husband. She responds, I have no husband. She thinks she has dodged the question by saying, I don't have a husband. And Jesus says, well, technically, yes, you have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the guy you're currently living with, he is not your husband. Much has been written and been preached on this Samaritan woman with five husbands. And the traditional interpretation is, and many of you have heard it, she was bad at marriage. Five tries, five failures. And now she's shacked up with a sixth guy. She's living in sin. She's a fallen woman with a bad reputation. There's another interpretation, however, put forth by some feminist theologians that deserves a closer look. I've shared this with some of you in our Bible study. The Samaritan culture practiced something called mirabite marriage. If a woman's husband died, it was required that the next of kin would marry her. And if he died, the next of kin would marry her, and so forth and so on. It kept going. It is possible then that this sixth man was next of kin to her previous husband, and just for fear of his life decided, I'm not going to marry this lady. So he simply lived with her and put a roof over her head. Now this, of course, I suggest, was cause of shame on her part. She was a victim of what would be called a stacked system against women. And she was probably judged harshly by the community. And here she was, having been through five marriages and still coming up empty, coming up hurting, coming up wanting, thirsting for some kind of stability, some kind of relationship. And here's a woman, and she says, you know, maybe this time I'm going to get this one right. Maybe there is somebody there. Is there somebody who's going to fulfill me? This is the one that's finally going to bring happiness and fulfillment. But it doesn't happen. She continues to thirst. What about us? You may not have been through five husbands, but however you may have been through five careers, five different degree programs, five different romantic relationships, maybe some weight problems that just somehow didn't work, or some how to stop this habit program. I had a mom who had one addiction that killed her. She was a smoker. And my mom's testimony was this, you know, it's easy to quit smoking. I've done it over 20 times. You see, she longed for something more, but somehow she never found it. And that's so many of us. We long for something more. We're hoping for something a little bit better, but somehow it never happens. The thirst remains. The words of you two reverberate, and I still haven't found what I'm looking for. Note what the woman says next. Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Yes, she does see who Jesus is. Jesus is prophet. And do you know what a prophet does? A prophet tells the truth. A prophet is a truth teller. And by her seeing this in Jesus, he also sees the truth in her. And he's getting very close to that inner sanctum of her soul. And she is beginning to feel very uncomfortable with this conversation. In fact, I would suggest she's probably getting a little bit threatened. So what does she do? She changes the subject. She starts talking religion. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain. Total non sequitur. Why did she do this? I suspect she did this because Jesus was getting just a little bit too personal. He was just getting a little bit too close, intruding into that inner part of her that she was guarding and was just, nobody is going to get in. And she did this in an attempt to distract Jesus from the real important subject at hand, and that is the truth of her thirsty soul. Have you ever noticed how when you find yourself in an uncomfortable or threatening conversation, what do? You change the subject. You see, to remain in that subject makes you vulnerable. You get exposed. It calls you to deal with that current truth and face the truth. And for many of us, dealing with that truth is just far too painful. So what do? We go into avoid mode, distraction mode. And why? We're getting blown out of our comfort zone, our safety zone. But that zone, I suggest, offers no real lasting comfort. Many years ago, I taught a Tuesday morning Bible study for men. It was a good group of men. I remember one guy, I'll call him Herb. Herb really got into the study. Herb was into his Bible, and Herb was flourishing. Herb was also dealing with a humongous challenge. He had a young wife in her middle 40s who was dealing with uterine cancer. And eventually, Helen died. I remember doing the funeral and dealing with a 46-year-old widow who was wondering, how is he ever going to get through this? He also had two teenagers that now he had to parent as a single parent. I remember he would come to Bible study, and he would study, he'd discuss, we'd have all kinds of good conversations. But the issue of Helen, the grief he was going through, never came up. About 6 weeks after his wife's death, I finally said to him one morning after the study, I said, Herb, you never talk about Helen. You never talk about what you're going through. And he said this to me, George, it's just too painful. Doing Bible study is safe, and I don't have to deal with the pain I'm experiencing. But that pain on his part, it never went away. And as long as he continued in avoid mode, the pain remained. Friends, I have known and work with so many people like Herb. It's so easy, and yes, it's so tempting to do Bible study. It's so tempting to talk religion. It's so tempting to get ourselves up to our ears in church work. But somehow, in all these activities, we never address the real important things of life. We continue to operate on a level where, as we refuse, we just cannot go any deeper. And that's a life of pain. And letting Jesus in and letting him address our real life issues, well, that can be very scaring and threatening stuff. But unfortunately, that is the reality for many of us. Back to the story. For some reason, we come to the end of the narrative, and we realize that Jesus indeed connected with that Samaritan woman. He got through, and that encounter with her, his getting through to her, the text indicates her life was changed. This is what the text reads. The woman left her water jar. She ran back to the city, and this is what she said to the people. Come and see a man who told me everything I've ever done, who knows me inside and out. You know, he just might be the Messiah. And what was their response? It's beautiful. They didn't take her word for it totally. What did they do? They went to see Jesus and check him out for themselves. And the conversation continued with those people with whom she shared her story. In turn, they went to see Jesus to continue the story. Here's the point I want to lift up to you in this narrative. Your story with Jesus, of Jesus in your life, can have a powerful effect on somebody else. It's simply a fact of taking what you've experienced, not keeping it to yourself, and telling somebody else how Jesus has made and is making a difference in your life. And this, let me also suggest, is the way Jesus continues to build and grow his church. One person telling another person. That is our possibility. That is our blessing. And my friends, that is our joy. You see, Jesus wants to know us, and he wants us, all of us, to know him. It doesn't get any better. Amen.
For a dream from some cool stream that I want.
Friends, my charge and my benediction. What is the Christian life? It's about knowing Jesus, letting Jesus come into your life and change it, transform it, and heal it. And in turn, telling another person what he has done for you. I love this definition of evangelism given to us by missionary D.T. Niles. Evangelism is one beggar telling another beggar where she has found bread. That's our possibility, and that's our joy. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said together, Amen.
Many a dream has died, like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to Father's heart. Into the world we're reaching out to show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to
we lift your name on high.
running.